Hey, good morning, everybody. It's great to see you guys today. Come on, let's worship together. Stand up with us as we sing.
Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word, just to rest upon his promise, just to know, thus saith the Lord. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I've proved him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more. Oh, how sweet to trust in Jesus, just to trust his cleansing blood, just in simple faith to plunge me neath the healing, cleansing flood. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I've proved him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more. Yes, 'tis sweet to trust in Jesus, just from sin and self to cease, just from Jesus simply taking life and rest and peace. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I've proved him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more. I'm so glad I learned to trust thee, precious Jesus, Savior, friend, and I know that thou art with me, will be with me to the end. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I've proved him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more. Amen. Amen.
When I fall, you are there by my side. You delivered me out of darkness. Now I stand in the hope of new life. By grace I'm free. You've rescued me. All
adoration to my Savior who saved.
on, Jesus. May we trust in you, God. Follow you.
Oh, how he loves us.
Thank you, Lord, for your love. You know, as I was singing that song, instead of singing, oh, how he loves us, sometimes it would just naturally come out like, whoa, how he loves us, whoa. And how true is that? You know, his love so deep, so great for us. Sometimes it's just like, whoa, whoa, God, your love is so great. Let's sing about that again, how deep the Father's love for us.
How deep the Father's love for us. How vast beyond all measure that he should give his only son to make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing loss. The Father turned his face away as wounds that mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory. Behold the man upon a cross, my sin upon his shoulders. Ashamed, I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is finished. I will not boast in anything. No gifts, no power, no wisdom, but I will boast in Jesus Christ, his death and resurrection. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart. His wounds have paid my ransom. Why should I gain from his reward? I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my ransom.
Yes, Lord. God, we thank you for your presence that is here as we gather, as we worship you in song this morning. God, and yes, of course, we pray for the service today, but more importantly, God, I just pray for our hearts today that as Chelsea would come and speak and just share with us what you have given her in her heart, God, that our hearts would be prepared today to receive the things that you want us to receive. And of course, God, we just thank you for your love and your grace that you pour out, that you show. And sometimes we can't explain it, we can't give an answer just for how awesome it is. But God, we can say thank you, and we can worship you with our lives in such a way that reflects that. May we do that today. May we do that each and every day. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thanks for worshiping. You may be seated.
Testing, there we go. Thanks. Thank you so much, Josh and team, for just leading us this morning. And these songs really just kind of encapsulated what we'll be talking about this morning, the Father loves. So I hope that we could just kind of bask in that this morning, bask in the Father's love. We have, we've been in this series called Touching the Father's Heart for several weeks now, and we're kind of exploring these characteristics of the Father that we find in Scripture. So we've heard about how Jesus really embodies and showed his disciples who the Father is and what he's like. And we've also heard about how the Father cares, how he comforts, and then how he serves. And just last week, Jim talked about how the Father sees our hearts. And this morning, I'm going to be sharing a little bit more about how the Father loves. And I know that this is one of the most, I think, one of the most confusing words in our culture today. And in some ways, it can be very polarizing because we all have different ideas of what love means, how it feels to give love, how it feels to be loved. So for now, I'm just going to focus on how the Father's love is sacrificial, how it is transformative, and how it is unifying. Will you pray with me? God, we are so thankful to be just in your presence. We know that you are with us. We know that you see our hearts. So God, I pray that that you would speak, that my words would be clear. God, that your love would be just kind of tangible and maybe clearer in a way. In Jesus' name, amen. So one of the things I find really important when we're reading scriptures is that we kind of understand the context of when it was written and to whom it was written, because the text cannot mean what it could not have meant to its original hearers. So it can't mean what it couldn't have meant when it was originally written to whom it was written. This is often where we can sometimes stray or misinterpret things that we read in the Bible. And of course, we're reading it through a different cultural lens, a different social lens, different political lenses, but we cannot change the meaning by picking and choosing what feels right, what fits with our own, you know, personal leanings. We need to trust the Holy Spirit to illuminate for us where the meaning and the power of the scripture is relevant for our lives today. So we're going to be looking at a couple chapters in John, mostly 16 and 17, if you would like to turn there a while. John 16 and 17. And in these chapters of John, Jesus is spending his last moments with his disciples. He's on the way to the cross, really. He knows what's ahead, and it's now starting to become a little more clear to his disciples as well. So I'm going to read pretty many verses, kind of straight through, and just point out some things along the way. And one of the things that you'll take notice of through these passages is the phrase, so that. And I watched a video by Francis Chan, and he kind of pointed out this as well, like the meaning of so that. It's interesting and noteworthy that as Jesus' life is kind of coming to an end, he's praying to his Father. Literally, the subtitle for chapter 17 in my Bible says, Jesus prays for himself. So he's praying for himself in front of his disciples, among his disciples. And he's kind of starting to explain why things have happened in his life and with the disciples and for history. He's explaining why it's happened the way it has. And this pivotal phrase, so that, he uses very often to kind of make that clear. So we're going to start in John chapter 16, verse 25. I've spoken these things to you in figures of speech. A time is coming when I will no longer speak to you in figures, but I will tell you plainly about the Father. On that day you will ask in my name, and I'm not telling you that I will ask the Father on your behalf, for the Father himself loves you because you have loved me and believed that I came from God. So this is kind of the first clarification of the Father's love. Jesus is saying, the Father himself loves you because you loved me. Verse 28, I came from the Father and have come into the world. Again, I am leaving the world and going to the Father. So his disciples said, look, now you're speaking plainly and not using any figurative language. Now we know that you know everything and don't need anyone to question you. By this we believe that you came from God. And I love this section because it's like the disciples are like, we've seen those miracles and things. Like, we've been with you this time, but now, finally, Jesus, thank you for being clear. Like, you've been kind of vague, you know, Sermon on the Mount, like, all these parables and stuff. They're like, now we believe. And isn't that like us, too? Like, I'm totally not pointing the finger because how often are we sometimes a little bit dense? Verse 31, Jesus responded to them, do you now believe? Indeed, an hour is coming and has come when each of you will be scattered to his own home and you will leave me alone. Yet I am not alone because the Father is with me. I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. You will have suffering in this world. Be courageous. I have conquered the world. And starting chapter 17, Jesus spoke these things, looked up to heaven, and said, Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son so that the Son may glorify you, since you gave him authority over all flesh, so that he may give eternal life to everyone you have given him. And this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, the one you have sent, Jesus Christ. I have glorified you on earth by completing the work you gave me to do. Now, Father, glorify me in your presence with that glory I had with you before the world existed. And this is an important phrase to remember. Glorify me in your presence with that glory I had with you before the world even existed. We're going to jump down to 17, verse 11. I'm no longer in the world, but they are in the world, and I am coming to you. Holy Father, protect them by your name that you have given me so that they may be as one as we are one. While I was with them, I was protecting them by your name that you have given me. I guarded them, and not one of them was lost except the son of destruction, so that the scriptures may be fulfilled. Now I am coming to you, and I speak these things in the world so that they may have my joy completed in them. I have given them your word. The world hated them because they are not of the world, just as I am not of the world. I am not praying that you would take them out of the world, but that you would protect them from the evil one. They are not of the world, just as I am not of the world. Sanctify them by the truth. Your word is truth. As you sent me into the world, I also have sent them into the world. I sanctify myself for them so that they may also be sanctified by the truth. I pray not only for these, but also for those who believe in me through their word. That is us. Jesus is praying for us right now because we have believed through the disciples' words, through our scriptures. So he's praying for us. It's exciting to me. Jesus is praying for me. May they all be one as you, Father, are in me and I am in you. May they also be in us so that the world may believe you sent me. I have given them the glory you have given me so that they may be one as we are one. I am in them and you are in me so that they may be made complete. May be made completely one that the world may know you have sent me and I have loved them as you have loved me. And here we hear this second phrase again, of where, because you loved me before the world's foundations. Father, I want those, verse 24, I want those you have given me to be with me where I am, so that they will see my glory, which you have given me, because you loved me before the world's foundation. Righteous Father, the world has not known you, however I have known you, and they have known that you sent me. I made your name known to them and will continue to make it known, so that the love you have loved me with may be in them and I may be in them. So that was pretty long. Thanks for sticking with me. We're going to look through these verses at kind of how the Father's love is sacrificial and transformative and unifying. But first, I do want to talk about what the Father's love is not. In a collaboratively written book called The Supremacy of Christ in a Postmodern Culture, D.A. Carson, who is a founding member of the Gospel Coalition, he has a chapter on the supremacy of Christ and love. And here he writes a bit of what the Father's love is not. He says, "What shall we make of postmodern voices that in the name of love deny the exclusive role that Jesus plays in mediating God's love to us?" We heard over and over again in these passages, Jesus is saying, love them because you have loved me, or that we can feel his love because of the Father's love. Carson says, will their siren tones increase love or even our understanding of love? Sadly, no. They merely restore idolatry under a new guise. Instead, Carson clarifies, Christian love is anchored in the Godhead, anchored in eternity, anchored in Christ, and anchored in the cross. And this can be really a slippery slope for us. We cannot remove Jesus from the story and simply focus on loving and accepting and even advocating for others, even the marginalized. We can't do this apart from Jesus. These are admirable missions, absolutely. And Jesus pioneered the way. He showed us these things. He embodies love and justice. This is why it's confusing and lines are often blurred and I don't have all the answers. But I know that we must not look at Jesus as merely a good example, or we have severely overestimated ourselves and gravely underestimated the work of our Creator, Savior, and Redeemer. Instead, the truest and purest of loves, the love of the Father, is sacrificial. We see this in one of the most well-known verses in the Bible, John 3:16. You can probably say it with me. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever would believe in him would not perish, but have eternal life. We know this, we hear this, but I think it's kind of lost its weight with us. And we have read about this, the Son. We read that God loved him before the world was even made, before we were even a thought. Carson writes, this is the place where God is supremely glorified, in the death, resurrection, and exaltation of his Son. The cross itself is the very foundation of all of redemption. It's first and foremost the result of the Father for the Son and the love of the Son for the Father. And Carson goes on to point out, which is counterintuitive to us, that we so often think that the ultimate motivation behind the cross was God's love for us. But instead, he argues, we must see that in John's gospel, the motivating power behind the entire plan of redemption was actually the Father's love for his Son and the Son's love for his Father. And I think too often we still can make too much of ourselves, thinking, of course, that God loved me so much that he would do this. And that's absolutely true. It absolutely is. I believe that. But maybe we elevate ourselves prematurely into God's plan and purpose and just miss this deep love of the Father for the Son. And it's really only out of this sacrificial love that we then get to join in the fellowship of believers in demonstrating this kind of love for each other. And this is transformative. This leads us into how the Father's love is transformative, how it changes us, and how, in other words, it sanctifies us. We see in verses 17 to 19, Jesus prays, sanctify them by the truth. Your word is truth. As you have sent me into the world, I also have sent them into the world. I sanctify myself for them so that they also may be sanctified or transformed or saved by the truth. And here I just want to give a plug for the Bible, because Jesus, in his own words, is saying that he, who is the Word made flesh, and this, our scriptures, are how we are transformed by the truth. We have a great need to keep coming back to this book. It must be our guiding light in life. Carson writes, "None of us poor sinners can ever be sanctified, set apart for God, apart from what the Lord Jesus has done by sanctifying himself. By sanctifying himself, Jesus perfectly obeyed his Father and therefore went to the cross to bear our sins. That is the good news. That is the gospel. The truth of the gospel is what truly sanctifies us." And finally, this brings us to how God's love is unifying. And I'll be honest, this aspect of the Father's love has really been the most moving, but equally kind of the most unfathomable as I am preparing, especially now in light of recent events. This idea that God's love is unifying, it just doesn't necessarily make sense to us that this love that Jesus talks about with his Father can somehow then translate to us and how we interact. And I do want to clarify that this is not saying uniformity. It's not saying we're all the same, believe the same, but rather this unification for the sake of others in order to glorify the Father and Son. But it doesn't really make immediate logical sense to us. Like marching around the city of Jericho probably didn't make sense to the Israelites. Or building a massive boat in the middle of a desert probably didn't make sense to Noah. And neither did Jesus' death, the death of a king, make sense to us. But God's ways and the way of the kingdom rarely make sense to us and our human logic. But this is where the Holy Spirit is at home, in the unexplainable. And this is when we get to practice trust. And this is when the fruit of the Spirit is developed, when we must actively do battle, waging war against our flesh and the lies of the enemy and of this world. We proactively fight even and especially the sin in ourselves, to give grace like we have been given, to forgive like we've been forgiven, to choose the joy that has been made complete in us, like in verse 13. This is all so that Christ is glorified and the world may believe that God sent Jesus. Again, verse 21 says, "May they all be one, as you, Father, are in me and I am in you. May they also be in us, so that the world may believe you sent me." And I have to just pause and let that sink in, because we are called to be one as the Father and Son are one. I'm like, we can't even decide what we're going to have for lunch. And we're called to this kind of of unity. Jesus prays that we as believers would model this Trinity, this Godhead relationship amongst ourselves. This is sacrificial and transformative in itself. And it's only possible when we are yielded to the Holy Spirit, when we allow our belief and our trust in Jesus to undergird and overshadow and shape our differences for his glory. So I'm going to invite the worship team back up. We're going to close in with this song, This I Believe, which is really just kind of coming back to these truths of what we believe, who Jesus is and what has been done for us. And I'm going to just share a song, some lyrics from the song, Surely We Can Change. It's a bit of a prayer as well from David Crowder. The problem is this, we were bought with a kiss, but the cheek still turned even when it wasn't hit. And I don't know what to do with a love like that. I don't know how to be a love like that. And all the love in the world is right here among us. And hatred too. So we must choose what our hands will do. Where there is pain, let there be grace. Where there is suffering, bring serenity. For those afraid, help them be brave. Where there is misery, bring expectancy, and surely we can change. Surely we can change something.
Thank you, Chelsea. Stand with us as we close in worship today.
Our Father everlasting, the all-creating one, God Almighty, and through your Holy Spirit conceiving Christ the Son, Jesus our Savior. I believe in God our Father, I believe in Christ the Son, I believe in the Holy Spirit, our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. Our judge and our defender suffered and crucified. Forgiveness is in you. Descended into darkness, you rose in glorious life. Forever seated high. I believe in God our Father, I believe in Christ the Son, I believe in the Holy Spirit, our God is three in one, I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again, for I believe in the I believe.
Singing that with us this morning and reminding us of that unity that we have and what we believe and what God's love does. Yeah. So go in peace today. Have a blessed day. Thank you for being here and worshiping with us.